yard, and we're collecting bees to install in our mini mating nucleus colonies. We need approximately one frame of bees for each nuke that we're going to be making up. And we want to get young bees out of the brood chamber because they'll live a long time in these nucleus colonies, and they accept queens well, and it's just best to start with young bees. So the first thing we do is we find the queen and cage her, put her in a little cage like this. We definitely don't want to be shaking the queen out, so we cage her first, and then we pick five frames from each colony to shake bees out of. And we shake them into this bulk bee box that is has ventilation on the bottom. There's two frames here hanging there with some food on those frames. And then this is a funnel up in the top that we shake the bees down into here. And then the bees can hang out in there. And later on, we'll scoop the bees out to add to the nucleus colonies. So let's get started, Dave. We'll grab our five frames from each one. See all the bees there. I like to just leave the frames outside the hive so I can keep a good count of how many we've done from each hive. We're going to do five from each hive. That's pretty much all there is to it, just pulling them out, shaking them off. There's little stops built into here so we can bang the frames on them. These colonies have a lot of brood in them, so they'll very quickly replace the bees that we've shaken out. Just hold that frame up there, Dave, so you can see all that brood that's going to be hatching out to replace these bees. One, two, three, four, five. So we're done with that one. So now these frames can go back in. And we move on to the next hive. So I'd just like to explain how this mini mating nucleus colony is arranged and how it functions. This is the feeder, a trough area there that we can fill up with sugar syrup or candy. There's a queen excluder in between there so the queen can't get into this area, because they can build comb in this area and the queen could be laying in there. That would be difficult to find her there. So that's what that queen excluder is for. Then each of these frames is made up in a way that they have no bottom bar, and we put a strip of foundation in, and each year we start with having them build new comb. So we melt these out when we're done with it at the end of the year. So that's the one frame. You can see on that frame we have half of a pheromone strip, and you can also see how attractive that is for the bees. So that pheromone strip smells like a queen, and it helps to hold the bees inside these nucleus colonies. They have no brood, no comb, no queen, and so they're prone to absconding from them. That little strip of queen smell holds the bees in there until they get a queen hatching out. So we have three frames set up in there like so, and the feeder, the queen excluder, the frames. On the front we have ventilation, because when we make these nucleus colonies up and we close them, they need to be able to breathe, but we don't want them to be able to fly. So we have lots of ventilation in here. We set them up, and then the following morning we open up the entrance, and then they can fly, and we've removed that ventilation so they're not getting too chilled at night. So they then have an entrance hole. On the bottom of the nucleus colony is a slide that pulls up so that we can pour the bees in. So that gives us access to pour the bees in, and there's lots of space in there because there's no comb inside the box. And when it's in this position here, it has ventilation at the bottom as well, so they have flow through ventilation when we have the entrance closed. Venting here and venting at the bottom of the nucleus as well. So now we'll load them up with bees. Okay, so now we're ready to put the bees into the mini nucleus colonies. We have our bulk bee box here with the screen all around. We've brought back from the other yard, and we're going to be scooping bees out of those to add into the nucleus colonies. So I'm going to be scooping the bees out and dumping them in. Dave's going to be closing the nukes up and flipping them over and banging them down to get the bees to the bottom of the box. And then Stephanie is going to be pouring sugar syrup in, and then Brooke is going to be putting the cells in after that. Let's go. So we open it up, get it ready to open, and then bang it down hard, and then shake the frames, shake the frame, and now spray water in quickly so the bees aren't all flying up. We wet them down like this so they don't fly, and periodically we need to reapply more water. And then we take our scoop and we scoop up the bees. But you can see what they look like in the bottom here. Just a big mass of bees in the bottom. And we'll measure up a cup and a half. There's a cup and a half there. And then we dump them in. And then Dave takes over. Cup and a half. Dave closes those up, bangs them, and then you can see that Stephanie's pouring in the sugar syrup, and then Brooke will be putting in the cell. The goal here is to move along pretty quickly so that we don't have a lot of bees up in the feeder and who would get drowned with the sugar syrup. So we've loaded the bees up into these nucleus colonies, and now we're setting them out into the yard. We leave them in place overnight and then open them up the following morning. But these are in a different location than where we collected the bees from, so they will orient to this new location. Take them over, and we set them onto cement blocks and then strap them into place, because the raccoons will get in here and tip them and drink the syrup. So we have them on the cement blocks like that. It gets them up out of the grass so the queens and bees can get in and out quite easily, but the coons can't tip them over to access the syrup. Tomorrow morning we're going to come back. We will pull out this tack, which keeps the door shut. We'll move it up and we'll put the pin in place here. And that keeps the lid from falling down, because they get kind of loose over time. So we would come back tomorrow morning and open these up. That way they gradually fly out and orient to their new location. 2 weeks from now, we'll come back and we'll go through and find the mated queens, remove them and put another cell in. And so these nucs can carry on. And we can typically get about 5 rounds of queens out of each of these nucs. So we're back here after 2 weeks. 2 weeks ago we made up these nucs and we put in a queen cell into each one of them. Those queens have hatched out, flown out and mated, and hopefully started to lay eggs. We're going to harvest the queens at this point and put them in cages so that we can use them in other colonies or sell them. So to go through this, what we do is we unstrap the hive. We hold with our thumb on the bottom here, and then pull gently up on the lid, and then flip that lid over beside here, turn the box, and first of all have a look at the queen cell. We could see that the queen has hatched out. It's open at the bottom there, so we're done with that. Then we pry the frames, all three frames, to loosen them up. I like to take this frame out first and look for the queen, and there she is. Very often the queen is on this frame, and we've got eggs I can see in there. She's a good size. She's motoring around, but she's mated and is laying, so we can now pick her up and mark her. As we're taking frames out, and it may be one frame or two frames or even three frames before we find the queen. So we can just lay those frames like that on the lid. Occasionally we find the queen inside the box. So we try to move through these frames quickly and catch the queen while she's still on a frame. If she's inside the box, we then have to use our hive tool and play a little bit of hockey with her and just gradually move her towards the top like that so that we can then pick the queen up. But this time we're fortunate we found the queen on the first frame, so we'll now mark her. And we'll clip the right wing since it's an even year. I got a little bit of honey on the wings here. There we go, got that separated. And then we're going to put that queen into a cage, like so, and pick out attendants. We're looking for very young looking bees to put in here. And we'll put five attendants in with the queen. You see how I'm covering that hole up with my finger and just opening it up enough to pop another bee in there. And we put five in. I've missed a couple, so there we go. And then the next thing we do is put the candy into place. These cages come with candy tubes that we can slip into place here. And there it go. That's all ready to be mailed off to another beekeeper or installed in another colony. So that's how we cage, mark, and clip our queens. Now, if I came to this hive and there was no queen present in the hive, what I would do is add another frame of bees from another nucleus colony, and that what we would do is transfer a frame that has eggs and larvae on it into this colony so that it's in a more of a position that will accept queens and it doesn't lose strength. So we always switch a frame out. We always switch the frame that has the pheromone strip on it, and that's an easy one to identify, and we know it goes right here. You'll see that the frames that are in this position are shorter because there's a molding in the bottom of the box right below that frame. And so this frame has to go back in that position. The bigger one won't fit down in. So we always have to put the frames back in the same order. And if we're switching one from one box to another, again, we switch the frame that has the queen pheromone strip on it. We have to be careful that when we're closing these up, that we get our lid on nice and tight. We're going to come back in a minute and put in the queen cells. That'll go right in there. But there's this queen excluder here. If we don't have the lid on tight, a queen could get over that and get into here. And you can see they've built some comb in this area, so she could be laying eggs there. And it's much harder to deal with a queen if she's on this comb in the feeder position here. So I always make sure that the lid goes back on nice and tight. But that's a little nuke that's ready to put a queen cell in. We go through all the nucs first, find all the queens, cage them, and then we go back afterwards and put the queen cells in. So you'll see that coming right up. So we're ready to put the queen cells in now. We open up the hives and then put the cells in. As you can see, we're keeping the incubator in the shade so it doesn't overheat. But when we open that up, we have our cells in here. We keep them vertical and we handle them gently. So Stephanie's going to open up those nucs now. And as she's opening them up, I'll be putting a cell in, like so. So everyone gets a cell. And then as soon as we've got all the cells in, we close the nucs back up. And you'll notice Stephanie is getting those lids nice and tight, so that the queen can't get over into the feeder area. Because if there's comb in there, she'll lay eggs on it if she can get in there. So she's closing up nice and tight. And then we'll strap them back down to their hive stands. And we'll come back again in 2 weeks to harvest another round of queens. So just a little recap of this whole process. We prepare the nucleus boxes with new strips of foundation. We put in the pheromone strips. Then we go out to a bee yard. We collect bees at a different location in a bulk bee box. We bring them back to this location, dump in a cup and a half of bees, fill up the tank with sugar syrup, add a queen cell, and then set them out into place. We open them up the following morning. 2 weeks later, we come back and hopefully we have a mated queen in each of these little nucleus colonies. It's very easy to find queens inside these because they're so small. That's one of the chief advantages. They use very few bees, very few resources, and they're easy to find queens in. I love them.